to the Swedish Institute of International Affairs. I am Mats Karlsson, its director, and to my side here I have Nils Svarts, who is acting managing director of the Swedish Civil Contingencies Agency in Sweden, known as MSB, and probably globally too. We have between our institutes, or between our institutions, a history of collaboration which we have wanted to take to a new level. This is one such occasion, and we have this opportunity to talk about something on which I am not an expert, but which you are, and it touches Sweden as much as international issues. We have a day ahead of us. It's going to be really exciting. I'd just like to make one reflection before I let you introduce the day. We celebrate, of course, that Agenda 2030 is with us, many other frameworks for international collaboration. I happen to have been part of the creation of the Millennium Development Goals, went to work in the World Bank in 2000, and one of my first tasks was to visit West Africa, where three countries were involved in a fantastically difficult situation: Sierra Leone, Liberia, and Guinea-Conakry, with refugees and disasters all over the place. And the reflection one had then was, there is no coordination. There was a lot of thinking at the time on what needed to be done over the coming years. Many attempts came and lots of lessons were learned. And I think that the world is in a far better place now than it was in dealing with such complex crises. And Margareta, I want to pay a special tribute to you, since you are one of the international systems most knowledgeable persons in this field. And you and I worked in the bowels of the UN system for many years trying to change it. And it is changing, albeit slowly. One could say perhaps now that we've come so far in understanding change, understanding the need for much better global governance, and actually have frameworks to deal with it, something is happening in global politics that is undermining our long-term ability to actually deliver on what we know can be done. I guess we can't deal with all of the politics in this room, but we certainly can deal with some of the understanding of what it is that needs to be done, our own preparedness, our own mindset, and our ways of willing to work together. And with an operational institution like yours, and a knowledge one like mine, maybe we can do something together now and in the future. Nils, please.
Thank you. Welcome. Thank you much for that excellent introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, I am very honored to stand here together with Mats, the director, and welcome you to this very exciting seminar on the topic of disaster risk reduction. MSB has worked with the Swedish Institute of International Affairs for many years now, in different ways, but our cooperation in this area of disaster risk reduction is fairly new. I'm very pleased with how the partnership has developed. We are not only doing this single event together with UI, we also have engaged some of Matt's researchers to help us think and write about the issues that we will be discussing here today. We have, for example, a joint study project focused on how to improve governance, as you addressed, on disaster risk reduction. At MSB, we also have an excellent and long understanding and cooperation with UNICDR. In fact, we like this organization so much that we choose to work with those who aren't not longer employed there, but who continue to be ambassador for this good cause. And I'm, of course, thinking of Margareta Wahlström. It's a pleasure to have you here. We have some very interesting panels ahead of us, and I promise to keep this introduction rather brief, But before we open the floor for all these distinguished speakers, I would like to say a few words about MSB and our mission in disaster risk reduction. MSB is a national focal point for the Sendai Framework in Sweden. We're very pleased about this, and we take this commitment very seriously. Our role in the area of disaster risk reduction is as wide as the framework itself. One of our core tasks at MSB is to facilitate coordination action before, during, and after emergency and crisis. We work with a wide range of stakeholders in society, both public and private, and we also work across levels of government, from the local to the national level. In our work with the Sendai targets, we try to use our existence coordination platform for and process as much as possible. We do, for example, draw on our national risk and capability assessment to identify concrete measures to increase societal resilience in Sweden. As a matter of fact, we are handing in our latest assessment report to the government in a week's time. I visit them this morning, they're working like with it. In this report, we pay particular attention to resilience building, measuring with 7 priority areas: energy, food supply, transportation, healthcare, financial service, communication, and last but not least, protection and security. But MSB mission does not stop in Sweden. We also have an important role internationally. We provide immediate humanitarian relief in support of the UN or EU, and we also have a more long-term missions to help other countries strengthen their system for disaster risk management. Gender equality is a core issue for the Swedish government in this area, and it's also a key concern for us in our dialogue with the countries and partners. I'm delighted that our State Secretary, has she arrived yet? Not yet. For international development or cooperation, Ulrika Moder, which you will meet later, is giving a broader presentation of the Swedish priorities in this field. For us at MSB, it's very clear that disaster risk reduction requires a whole of society approach. We need to engage everyone, and the local level is absolutely instrumental. I know that Margareta Wahlström often calls the municipalities the movers and the shakers in this disaster risk reduction, and it's absolutely true. This is also clearly emphasized the European Forum for Disaster Risk Reduction in Istanbul last month. I'm very pleased that we have a representative from the local level, from the city of Jönköping, Fredrik Jonsson, whose face I don't... There we have Fredrik. Great. Jönköping has been on the forefront of disaster risk reduction for many years now, and I'm sure that we will hear many of the inspiring examples and lessons learned from Fredrik. One of the areas we are struggling a bit at the national level is in gathering disasters loss data. Having such data is important in order to put a price tag on the cost of disasters and to be able to compare across regions and countries. But this is a complex task for many reasons and an area we are need to have more cooperation in. First of all, we need cooperation with the private sector, who sits on a lot of important information in this area. I'm also thinking of innovative actors like the Global Challenge Foundation, which we'll hear more about from Mats Andersson in the second panel. And I don't Mats Andersson in... Happy to see you here. And we need more international cooperation to benchmark and share good examples. We are working with this issue in the EU. I also know that OECD has a lot of valuable experience in this area. I am sure that Jack Radish. Oh, you're hiding. Please stand up, Jack. Your face. Thank you. will give us some reflections in this first panel on the international perspectives. Finally, I'm also happy to have my Canadian colleague here in Stockholm, Stephanie Durand, who is Acting Deputy Minister at Public Safety Canada. And here we have Stephanie. And we had dinner last night, so I sure know her face. An excellent dinner, I would say. We are currently kickstarting our bilateral cooperation on the science and technology with Canada. And we see a cooperation in this field of disaster risk management as one of our more promising areas for bilateral exchange. Canada and Sweden has a lot in common, not least in terms of the risk that our countries are facing. And I believe we have a strong mutual interest in learning from one another. Ladies and gentlemen, we have two very strong panels today. The seminar provides us with opportunity to have a vivid and open discussion, but also hopefully to focus our minds a bit before the next month great happening, the global platform in Mexico. And with these words, I wish you excellent discussion, and I will hand over the floor. And I'm so sorry I couldn't be with you, but that's due to that I have two calendars for the moment. The Director General for MSB has became the National Auditor, so she left the calendar, and I still have my own calendar. So I have to leave you because this was. I hope you will have a great day, and I'm looking forward to the report for my colleagues here. So you take the floor, Mats. Thank you.
I thank you, Mr. Chairman, as well.
Well, good luck and keep us safe, huh, Nils? All right, we start the day. And I would like to start by welcoming Margareta Wahlström up to the podium. Would you do us the honor, Margareta? She has, as I mentioned, worked for many, many years in the United Nations system. And if you call someone else mover and shaker, I can tell the rest of the world you're certainly one of them inside that system and has been. And it's great to have you back in this area. I would then like to ask the panelists to come up. Stephanie, welcome all the way from Canada. Andrew Maskery from the UN system itself. And of course, Jack Radish, whom I said hello to earlier, from the OECD. There you are. And with that, I'm actually going to sit down and enjoy a very interesting discussion. Margareta, over to you.
Thank you, Mats, and thank you also to Nils, not only for keeping us safe, but also giving us a very good introduction to this day's discussion. I must say, I'm really very pleased and grateful to MSB and your institute that you wanted to take this on, because the state secretary is not here yet, but last year I met her about a year ago, and she said, you know, this is really difficult. Sendai is not known in Sweden. What can we do? So we started talking about what, you know, how do we actually bring this into the 2030 agenda? Many of you have been so involved in this, so for you it's crystal clear. But for far too many people, Sendai, disaster risk, risk management, all these things. It's not a separate box of tools, it's a toolbox to implement the 2030 agenda for a world that is more sustainable and more stable, I would say. So that's our common agenda. So that will be the theme of today. The panel, Stephanie Durand, Nils has introduced colleagues here. All of them have a very solid knowledge. We will aim to, the purpose of this exercise is one, to trigger your curiosity, if you are new to the topic, that you ask some tough questions to challenge the panelists, please, or just informative questions. And also think about the global platform that takes place in next month. What should be an outcome of that GP that helps with the implementation of Sendai in Sweden or wherever you are located, because that's the purpose of the global meetings on disaster risk reduction, is to constantly move the agenda forward. And the overall theme of our discussion is, of course, Sendai, but Sendai is not just a document. Sendai is a product of 10 years of work of 170 countries in the world, Sweden among them, and many people saying, what's the problem, what do we need, etc. So it's a product that I think reflects, even though it's written in UN language, but I do believe it reflects actors, activists, governments' concerns about risk management. And that's what we'll put to the test today. So in this panel, we will have first an introduction to put you all on more or less the same plate of risk reduction over the past 10 years. Andrew will give you that introduction. Andrew's job has been to be the coordinator of the production of the Global Assessment Report for Disaster Risk. And there are four of them. And he's done an executive summary of the four. Plus, I think he's trying to project where we go with risk management on that basis. Jack Radish, OECD, we work together, UNISDR and OECD, on risk management for the High-Level Risk Forum, which is a governmental entity. And Stephanie, for sure, has participated in that forum and in all the other things, but also has a very important experience from building this risk reduction, risk management. You will see that there will be slightly different utilization of terminology here, even though we have just agreed in the UN General Assembly on an approved terminology. The terminology issue is still a major challenge for all of us. So we know that, so don't get upset. Accept it and listen carefully. So with that, I welcome Stephanie, Jack, and Andrew. And Andrew, this panel will go on to 10:30. I will not say anything more, except I will ask questions. I will ask Andrew to first give his introduction, and then I will ask the question to Jack and Stephanie on this 25 months, essentially, since we said goodbye to each other in Sendai in Japan, where we negotiated in blood, I would say, way beyond our allotted time. But we concluded. And since then, 25 months, what has really been the issues, the progress, the challenges? Have we managed to make full use of this instrument that belongs to you, actually? So with that, Andrew, you have a maximum of 20 minutes, and you have a PowerPoint, do you? I think maybe you should stand over there then, so you can maneuver your...
Manipulate it. Okay, thank you very much, Margareta, and thank you all for being here. So as Margareta said, I'm going to give a little bit of a summary from the four UN Global Assessment Reports on Disaster Risk Reduction, which we've produced since 2007. Margareta was actually chair of the advisory board of a report, and Johan Shah, who's sitting in front of me, was also a very important advisory board member. But as Margareta said, I'm going to not just look at the past, but also see, you know, what we've learned from all this and how that projects us into the future as well. So I think a first point to make is when we actually arrived at Sendai about 25 months ago, we'd actually already had 25 years worth of international commitments to disaster risk reduction, starting with the international decade in 1989. So we've got we had the Millennium Development Goals, and we've had all the climate change agreements. And if one wants to go even further back into agreements which were not labeled disaster risk reduction, but actually had a lot of relevance to disaster risk reduction. The UN Convention to Combat Desertification, very relevant for drought, was signed in 1994. And the Ramsar Convention, which is to protect wetlands, again, extremely important for DRR, goes back to 1971. So we've actually been quite busy negotiating and signing international agreements on this and around this subject for quite a long time. The trouble is despite the international agreements, the growing body of evidence we have tells us that losses are still going up. Over the last few months, we've done a count, and we now have something like 90 countries worldwide which have reasonably good national and local disaster loss data. And if we actually analyze this data, the trend is a definite upward trend. So we're looking here at just housing damage. And I've deliberately here chosen from extensive small and medium scale disasters. So this really takes out the peaks you might get from the very large events. But it's something that's been going up continuously since 1990. So we have all these international agreements, but the losses are still going up. The problem with using historical data is that the past is not a very good guide to the future, and it's an increasingly less good guide to the future. This is a sort of a make-believe chart of potential peaks and troughs in water, I mean in rain and drought. And if you look at this, that's sort of over 1,000 years. Even if we had an excellent 100 or 150 year sample, just say we actually had very, very good historical data on the last 100 or 150 years, it doesn't really tell us very much about the major peaks and the major troughs that may have been in the past. So if we really want to understand where we're going, we have to, in a sense, recognize the historical data but go beyond it and really start to model risk using probabilistic techniques that can tell us about future probabilities and also looking at some of the long-term, long-tail risks, 1 in 1,000, 1 in 10,000 year events, which may happen. So we do that by basically building up sets of what we call synthetic hazard sets, looking at all the possible events that could happen, and then we combine that with data on the exposure of human settlements, agriculture, etc., and their vulnerability to come up with risk metrics. Since 2011, in the United Nations, we've worked on what we call a global risk model, a fully probabilistic, multi-hazard open model. And that now tells us we're in a world in terms of average annual loss of almost $300 billion a year, which is a lot of money. When we say average annual loss, we're not talking about the historical loss, what you lost last year, or necessarily what you're going to lose next year. This is looking at all the future events that could happen and then averaging them out. So it's a way, I think an easy way to think about this is if you were actually saying, well, I need to cover myself against all the disasters that might happen in my lifetime, that's the amount of money every year the world should be sticking underneath the mattress to protect itself. And we have a distribution, in every country and territory of the world. But having that sort of brute, let's say, gross risk information is very, very useful. But what are really the implications for countries? So we've done a lot of other modeling work in the GAR. This one is telling us which countries have public finances that would be able to actually absorb an extreme loss. And again, we just took a scenario here, the maximum 1 in 100 year loss that a country could potentially have. Would its public finances, its capacity to actually absorb those losses, manage? And if we sort of toggle backwards and forwards, you can see it's a very different map to the previous map. It's a very different group of countries. But this is really important information for governments to know. I mean, can I absorb a serious loss? We can also use risk metrics to tell us about our capacity or our ability to achieve the SDGs. If our annual average loss is a high percentage, for example, of what we're currently willing or able to spend on social expenditure, health, education, social protection, that expenditure is unlikely to be sustainable in the long term. And the higher the percentage of our risk compared to social expenditure, the less we're going to be able to sustain that. So again, we've produced information comparing risk to social expenditure, to capital investment, to a range of other development indicators. And we can now tell which countries are going to actually be extremely challenged to achieve or not to achieve different SDGs. In the case of the small island developing states, so those are the small islands in the Caribbean, Pacific, and the Indian Ocean, risk is really an existential threat. And the risk metrics are in a completely different dimension. It's quite simple to understand why. If a hurricane, for example, hits the United States, as it did in New Orleans 10 or so years ago, however big it is and however big the magnitude of the loss, it's only affecting a fairly small part, small proportion of the population, the territory and the economy. If it affects a small island, it's often affecting 100% of the population, the territory and the economy. So this graph is, again, comparing risk to social expenditure, capital investment, and the value of capital stock across some of the small islands. And it really tells us that for these countries, I mean, unless risk can be addressed, particularly in a context of climate change, the future is uncertain indeed. We also believe, you know, the world needs to focus in, as I said, on the long tail risks. These are ones with extremely low probabilities of occurrence, but extremely high severity. Some of these we've looked at are the ones that are associated with tsunamis, which can often then produce what we call synchronic failures or sequential crisis, as happened, for example, in Japan in 2011, when a tsunami knocked out the Fukushima nuclear power plant and really, you know, led to a sort of a cascading set of risks which rippled out worldwide. This is just exposure to tsunamis. It's not actually risk. But if you look on the right-hand side in terms of GDP and go a pretty six countries down and look at the risk in Hong Kong, I've been to Hong Kong and discussed this, and it's an unrecognized risk. And it's not just the UN that says it's an unrecognized risk. I've talked to the insurance industry and their risk modelers, and they agree with our figures. But it's the kind of risk that's lurking there. It may not happen. It's maybe a 1 in 500 or 1 in 1,000 year risk. But the potential impact for the global economy can be absolutely enormous. We also need to focus in on what the other side of the spectrum, what we call extensive risk, which are the highly frequent but low severity events. These are the ones which are really eroding local resilience. And this is, I think, as true in the developed world as the developing world. Most of our losses to local infrastructure, so this is water, sanitation, power, telecommunications, etc., aren't due to the 1 in 1,000 year events. They're due to the floods, storms, winds, landslides that are occurring hundreds of times a year. And again, this is data from our sort of sample of 90 countries that tells us that. And we've also done a lot of work, this was in the 2013 report, on how this impacts on business and the private sector. And again, particularly if we take the small and medium enterprise sector and again cross it with our disaster data, the sort of disasters that those companies have experienced and are worried about are exactly the same ones that you get from the small and medium scale extensive risks. But understanding risk is one thing, but I think beyond that, what the reports have been able to tell us is that there are a number of risk drivers that globally are what are actually pushing that risk up and what are pushing the losses up. A first one has to do with poverty, and it has to do with weak governance. And again, the data from our risk model tells us that basically countries which are poorer and which have less institutional quality, are weaker governed, generally have far higher losses. This is comparing Japan and Philippines in terms of mortality to cyclones. Same number of people exposed to the same number of cyclones of the same severity every year. Mortality in the Philippines modeled at around 17 times more. And underneath poverty, we also have to look at inequality. And this graph is a very nice way of looking at that. I think it's very illustrative. It's a graph telling us in a range of different countries how much local governments are able to spend on their citizens per year. Yeah? And if we're saying that local governments are the shakers and movers of disaster risk reduction, how much they can spend is actually a very important metric. Sweden, which is the second one down, seems to be able to spend somewhere around $9,000 per habitant per year. At the other extreme, in some parts of sub-Saharan Africa, we're down to less than $10 per inhabitant per year. So that's a way of looking at inequality in real terms, how it actually would affect our ability to implement disaster risk reduction. So there's an enormous capacity difference between some of the wealthier countries and some of the poorer. Climate change, one we all know about. Our colleagues in Miami developed these maps for us, explaining what Miami Beach might look like in 2060, mainly underwater. It's unfortunately not stopping a real estate boom that's still ongoing in Miami now in those very areas. And when we've actually modeled this, for example, in the Caribbean, which is just like basically saying, take today's climate out of our risk model and punch in tomorrow's climate from a risk scenario, we can now actually put dollar figures on what that additionality means. Just in the Caribbean islands, the additionality just due to wind in the average annual loss would mean about another $2 billion per year by 2050. The way we manage and plan our urban development is another important risk driver. These maps show the expansion of Delhi. But even in developed countries where we're perhaps growing at a far slower rate, the way we're managing our urban development doesn't necessarily contribute to reducing the risks. It can actually contribute to increasing. But the problem is that many of the cities which are growing the fastest are actually the cities with the weakest capacities to manage and plan urban development. So they really are crucibles of future risk. And we can see that these are 5 decades worth of risk accumulation in Cali, Colombia, a nice graph from our 2009 report. Someone earlier was talking about disaster loss data. This is loss data from the Cali Fire Services, who map flood events literally neighborhood by neighborhood. And you can see really the sort of prevalence of floods expanding decade by decade as the city expands concentrically. Something which I think Sweden knows all about, biocapacity and planetary boundaries. A lot of this data has come from Swedish research. But clearly our consumption patterns are causing very severe environmental degradation, another important risk driver. And we've actually modeled the prevalence of both land degradation and drought, for example, in Africa and the Middle East. And you can really see very, very clearly, not just on this map, but on other maps, how land degradation itself is actually a major driver of drought risk. And finally, probably one of the key underlying risk drivers is actually how we are managing risks. And unfortunately, we've not been doing a very, very good job. Every 2 years, we've been asking governments to report back to us on how they were actually implementing the Hyogo framework. This is the predecessor to the Sendai framework. The Hyogo framework had 5 priorities for action. Firstly, two observations we can make. Firstly, that every 2 years, governments give themselves higher marks. It's like, you know, I'm self-evaluating myself in my class at university. Naturally, I'll give myself a higher mark every 2 years. But apart from, even though the losses are going up, by the way. But the interesting thing here is that the fourth group of columns, which is actually addressing underlying risk, is the area where countries were consistently saying we're doing less well than in the other areas. So a summary of how we've been doing is actually we've been doing quite well in managing disasters, but not really quite so well in managing the underlying risks. And if we dig further down into that data, you can see this very clearly. In areas such as disaster preparedness and contingency plans, or developing the institutional and technical mechanisms to do so, countries have been rating themselves well above the average score, which is that orange line. If countries look at managing risk in urban environments or looking at the impacts of major development projects, they've been rating themselves far below the average line. So this is data from countries themselves. It's not us, our interpretation of what countries are doing. This is what governments have been telling us. We know sustainable development is possible. I mean, a few years back, the general assumption was there was a kind of a linear relationship between energy consumption and human development. The more people look at these kind of graphs, the more it becomes apparent it's not a linear relationship. It's possible to get high levels of human development measured on, for example, the UN Human Development Index with relatively low levels of energy consumption. So we know it's possible to do. The issue is how do we get there? And one of the problems is we have actually become sort of trapped in our own conceptual labels and our own frameworks. And this is really where we have to look at risk in terms of a sort of nexus between a range of different problems and not in different silos. We have agreements now on climate change, on sustainable development, and on disaster risk reduction. But if we're not careful, both internationally and nationally are going to lead to a duplication of efforts and go off in slightly different directions. I think everything I've said in the last 10 or so minutes in this presentation on underlying risk drivers tells us actually that most of the causes cross these frameworks. If I'm talking about, for example, protecting wetlands, which as we know has a very, very important role in regulating water flow and quality, I mean, it's a good question. And what am I doing? Am I doing environmental protection? Am I doing disaster risk reduction? Am I doing sustainable development? Or am I doing climate change adaptation? Actually, I'm probably doing all of those. And we're getting maybe too hung up about whatever conceptual label we particularly put on each one. So I think in the future, we really need to now look at approach using risk as a common language that sort of threads through all these different frameworks, and different ways of managing risk as strategies which can cross those frameworks. And we think that these are all in the Sendai framework, by the way, but the sort of preventing and avoiding new risk, the prospective risk management, is particularly important. But this is actually making sure that we have risk in all our new development as we go forward. But we also need to be reducing some of our existing stock of risk we've built up over the last few decades, and in some cases centuries, and obviously continuing to strengthen our resilience to shocks as they come up. But we now need to look at this in a much more holistic way, as a nexus between these different frameworks and not as separate silos. One of the areas we've been able to do this has actually been in the development of indicators. And I think one of the success stories we had last year was actually ensuring that the core global indicators that the member states, UN member states, agreed for the Sendai framework were also agreed for the SDGs. So this chart just shows you how some of those indicators link across the sort of seven Sendai targets and some of the targets from goal 1, 11, and 13. So that's the poverty, the urban development, and the climate change goal of the SDGs. We now need to do the same with the Paris Agreement and with other agreements. The more coherence we can get on indicators as well, this is really going to really help us go forward. But some of the challenges we see for the future, we really believe the risk modeling work not only has to sort of continue, but has to expand. We still really only understand globally risk in the built environment. We need to bring in agriculture. We need to bring in food and water, which we believe are, due to climate change, are going to be key global challenges over the next 10 to 20 years. And we need to make sure this is really informing not just the insurance industry, which risk models currently do, but also public and private investment, humanitarian action, climate change adaptation, DRR, this gamut of conceptual labels we've built for ourselves, and really looking at the trade-offs between risk and opportunity, because this is all about, in investment terms, discount rates. It's, you know, how much risk I'm willing to take for how much opportunity in terms of future return on my investment, and coming up with something reasonable which allows us a sustainable future. I've mentioned indicators, and we really think we need to continue this work on indicators that cross the three or four different frameworks, and also revisit some of these old frameworks. What indicators were there on the Ramsar Convention, on the Desertification Convention, which maybe we've forgotten about altogether? How do we bring these into the picture? And finally, you know, I think we still need additional work at all levels, from the UN, the global level, down to the local level, in terms of how we can actually manage risk in our countries, at the international level, and at the local level. We need new models of governance, which brings the public and private and global and local level together, and that really does help us in a very practical way break down these silos we've been discussing. So I'll finish there. Thank you very much. And we have actually a new GAR product. It's an atlas, which brings together all the risk metrics from the previous reports, which we will be launching in Cancun. So I hope you enjoy. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Andrew. Did you think this was a gloomy picture? No. So that's why we have Jack and Stephanie here, of course, because now they will tell us...
I'll turn it around.
What actually happens? What do governments do? You know, once I asked the government in the 2015, so many negotiations, so much optimism, I would say, around what these new policy frameworks were going to do for us. And then I asked one senior official who was very critical in this negotiation. I said, "What, when all this is over, what do governments do with these policy frameworks?" So he said, "Well, we go home, we send it out to the ministers and tell them to do their job." And then what? Or you ask them if they have done the job, or what happens? So I think that still is the question we need to understand better. How we can actually, I mean, I say we, it's not just UN, of course, it's all of us who are carrying some expertise, even within institutions. When you are coordinators as MSB, how do you assist institutions, people, business sector, you know, local governments to make full use of all this knowledge, as Mats also said, we have the knowledge, how do we make full use of it? So Stephanie, Canada, you actually featured quite high as a country there, you noticed.
All that.
I saw you reacted to that. So I think it's very good if you tell us where Canada is.
Sure. I'm going to follow your lead and go at the podium. It'll be easier. Donc bonjour tout le monde. Hi everybody. I'm Stephanie Durand, and it is my first time in Sweden. So I've had. I just want to thank both the Institute for the invitation, so thank you very much, as well as MSB. And I've had a short stay, but a wonderful stay, and I very much look forward to sharing our experience with all of you. So what I will say, Andrew, your presentation does resonate quite profoundly for the Government of Canada. And Canada, as you saw, we are hazard prone. We are a large and diverse country faced with a multitude of hazards, ranging from wildfires to floods to ice storms to earthquakes to hurricanes to heat. So we have quite the gamut of disasters. And I will say that what the framework provides, the Sendai framework, and its predecessor, the Hyogo framework, it provides us with the frame to play a leadership role with partners within government, within the whole of society. And we're just back from hosting the regional platform for disaster risk reduction in Montreal. Margareta, you'll recall 2.5 years ago when you attended our national platform back in Calgary, Margareta approached us to host the regional platform. It's great to see Margareta again. She's been a big supporter of our national efforts. So I'm the chair of the National Platform for Disaster Risk Reduction in Canada. And we have really taken hold of the governance aspect and bringing all different actors in a, I would say, inclusive dialogue. This is not a government problem. It is not a federal national problem by itself. It is a shared problem across all society, across all sectors. And bringing different levels of government, bringing the private sector, bringing NGOs, bringing the citizens, bringing indigenous communities together, as well as municipalities. What Sendai and Hyogo provides is a common frame, a frame to collapse the traditional hierarchical relationships, but to really go and leverage innovation, dialogue, because it is shared space. What I will say as well is that there is a new normal out there. We are no longer dealing with the same level of risks. Climate change, extreme weather patterns are here and are here to stay. And I think what really strikes me is as other initiatives, global initiatives are advancing, like climate change, like sustainable development, DRR has a very important role in that global conversation. And I think the success of Sendai will be breaking down those silos and really bringing that coherence to bear, because we're all resource strapped. There is a sustainability issue where we do need to think outside the box to really address the growing risk that Andrew certainly showed. We're all too aware as well that catastrophic events and extreme weather patterns impact on the economy. It is a significant line item, and you saw Canada is way up there as far as costs of disasters. And that's a conversation that it is a cost to not only the national government, it's a cost to provinces and territories, it's a cost to municipalities, to industry, and it's also a cost on productivity and also the psychosocial aspect of communities. So it's not only the hard cost of disasters, but it's the impact of disasters that really we need to quantify. And I'm not sure we really truly quantify the cost of disasters. What I will tell you is that in Canada, the risk profile has changed. We are seeing an increased number of events, increasing scope, increasing size, increasing in complexity. The interdependencies also, I would say, are increasing, which means that one disaster can have catastrophic impacts in other sectors. And what I'll say to that is that climate change, increased urbanization, technology dependencies, aging infrastructure, and demographic shifts must be noted. I will also say that recent events like the Fort McMurray wildfires, which I'm assuming you all heard about, were a devastation. We were fortunate that there was not deaths related to the wildfire per se, but deaths due to a car accident, but it was not because of burning and because of the wildfires. I will say as well that it does bring to bear resilience. And resilience, unfortunately, is now a trendy topic. Everybody's talking about resilience. But it is about how do we define what is true resilience. Resilience is about being resilient with respect to just being able to cope with the stress of disasters, to be resilient with respect to infrastructure, to be resilient as far as being prepared for the unknown. Because we all know that things will happen. It's not a matter of if it'll happen, it's a matter of when they will happen. As well, what I would say is that large-scale disaster continue to become more common and more costly. It is important to understand the data, to understand the evidence, so that we can make more informed decisions with greater return on investments. It is about not only focusing on the response and the recovery, but it is about hitting the disasters before they strike with mitigation and prevention. I will say that when Canada signed on to the Sendai Framework in 2015, we took that as a very significant commitment. And Public Safety Canada, the department that I am from, is a domestic a lead for the implementation across Canada. And we do that through our national platform. We have various working groups with the private sector, with Indigenous communities, with municipalities, to really advance the thinking and to bring new ideas to bear. That is not the only mechanism. I will say as well that absolutely there's a role for governments and there needs to be investments with respect to DRR and mitigation. However, governments can't do it alone. And in Canada, we have a federation where the federal government is not the one that's, you know, at the local level. Disasters do strike at the local, then it goes provincial, territorial, and then when the capacities cannot, when the capacities are not able to cope, the federal government does step in for disasters. But at the forefront of that is about understanding risks and the exposure, so that better decisions can be made, so that we can also look to the science and the technology to look at what we can do to not prevent risk, but to be prepared for the risks. We need to as well get better at predicting natural disasters, because they will happen. So it's about better preparedness, better mitigation, to then be able absolutely to respond and then to recover, but not to recover to the old normal, but to recover to a new normal, and that is the essence of building back better. So understanding our ability to manage disaster risks and really understanding where the risks truly reside, which includes understanding water flows, understanding flood mapping, then having regulation and incentive, because there's a consequence if the information is available and there's awareness. But that is a political decision that requires as well political will. It's not just about understanding risks. So it is about working together as public service, as academia, as really understanding and building that business case for good governance. What I will say is that as we hosted the regional platform for disaster risk reduction in March in Montreal, where we hosted 50 countries and territories from the Americas, we were able to negotiate a regional action plan. And you will say it's quite a diverse region, the region of the Americas. It is, but there is fundamental, I think, understanding of what is risk, the value of information sharing and best practices, and to learn from each other. But really, at the core, it's about involving whole of society. What I will say as well, in closing, is that there are opportunities that we need to leverage with the other global commitments, with the EU, with the OECD, with NATO, where resilience is also an important element of civil protection. And I very much look forward to the discussion with my esteemed colleagues, but also to understand that it's not a cookie-cutter approach. It is about understanding communities. It's about understanding and empowering communities to take that leadership space, and for the federal government and the global initiatives to provide tools that are practical, not just theoretical, but that can be implemented. And that sometimes is the struggle. It needs to be concrete, it needs to be simple, it cannot be overly bureaucratic, because it is about getting results. And lastly, what I will say is that building relationships, having these type of opportunities to share and to think outside the box, because this is new space. It's important to build on these partnerships, to keep the global conversations going on disaster risk, but to be sure that we define what is leadership in DRR. And leadership is about engaging, it's about empowering, it's about enabling. And I think, you know, with some of the countries that had the pleasure of working with and learning from each other, bringing the private sector, non-government organizations, academia, NGOs, and others to the table, we'll be able to build a more resilient country, a more resilient region, and a more resilient global environment. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Stephanie. Actually, I would like to say Canada has come a very long way, very rapidly, because 5 years ago, there wasn't a lot of enthusiasm around disaster risk reduction. It was sort of a very localized issue, so I'm very pleased to hear you. You did bring up some things that I think would like to come back to. We listened to Jack, OECD, industrial countries, do they have any risks that they worry about? And how do they deal with them? And after that, I'll open the floor so all of you can engage with our speakers here. Jack, please.
Thank you very much, Margareta, and thank you once again, Mr. Director, for the invitation. Real pleasure to be here, and if I may, great thanks to our OECD delegate from Sweden, Bengt Sandelius. Pleasure to see you too, Professor. It's a very hard act to follow, or I should say two acts to follow. Excellent presentations who have covered so many of the important points. I'll do my best to highlight some of the work the OECD has been doing since Sendai, which I think could be of interest to our discussions this morning. When we begin with an international strategy like the Sendai Framework, I was struck afterwards by the right away the action of UNISDR to say, how are we going to take words and put them to action? And I don't know if that was the good thinking of your partners at Price Waterhouse who came up with it, but it was very effective. I think it got everyone to think, what next? And how do we get traction to make sure that we're having impact? I'm going to speak a little bit about... I'm a little bit taller, perhaps. Not as tall as most of the Swedes in the room, but... I'm going to talk a little bit about public management basics, and I hope that doesn't come off as boring. I think it is going to create a bit of a framework for thinking about how we can get from a large-scale international framework to the real local level and the actions that we need. When we look at international instruments, whether it's OECD or UNISDR, we always, of course, depend finally on the countries taking action. That's the first step. And this is an A to Z process, not an A to B. Otherwise, it would be a very truncated, top-down, monolithic, and finally ineffective process. Once the national strategies are put into place, well, what incentives are in place afterward to act on them? Are there national strategies in place? Is there any institutional leadership at national level that is coordinated and putting in place incentives for subnational levels of government to act? Are those actions in the form of programs, in form of investments for DRR, are they aligned to the national strategies? Are they making use of the investments incentives that are put in place? Oftentimes, I see across OECD countries, massive tax incentives for DRR investment that are never acted upon. And the common thread of explanation for that is usually massive red tape. And oftentimes massive tax audits if the red tape is not complied with. So there's a lot of money for DRR investment in some OECD countries that's left on shelves. And that we could talk about regulation, regulatory reform. That's an area of governance that we should be looking at with regard to OECD country context for DRR investment. Are these programs being exercised, are they leading to training and tools at the local level and at the decision-making process for DR investment? And here I think Andrew touched on a very important point. And that is, when we talk about sustainable development and as an objective, and we talk about DRR as an objective, many times these are very well aligned. And Andrew pointed out the case of wetland protection, for example. In certain contexts, those are two objectives that are going to be very well aligned through a very concrete action. But sometimes what's done for the sake of sustainable development might actually undermine human safety. And I think the key word I took away from Andrew's presentation is trade-offs. Mm-hmm. And trade-offs, they're not easy. There's going to be one value that's preferred over another. And how do we get that right? I think that means coming back to a good point of governance is inclusiveness in the policy formulation stage. We need to have open processes of consultation of the people who are affected and the values that they attribute that could be affected by different public programs. I'll give just a very concrete example. Take the Loire River in France. The level of protection behind dikes, this comes down to the real technical cost-benefit analysis of investment in the dike system. And knowing how much space is going to be protected because of the dike system, how much investment will go into that dike system, it could be very easy to increase the protection level if they dredge the river. It would have very, very quickly a much higher levee system. But the trade-off there is that would lead to lifting up mercury from the silt in the riverbed and killing the indigenous river fish. So that is a policy against this. So if you want to raise the levee system, you have to pay a lot of money to move dirt or build concrete on top of it. And we're talking about thousands of kilometers of dirt and concrete, as opposed to dredging the river to save 1,000 fish. Now, that's not to downplay the importance of fish life, but if you compare that to the number of people whose lives might be at risk, that's the kind of discussion you need to have. How do you have those types of discussions in an effective way? There's a European flood risk directive that, of course, some of you might be familiar with. You need to have this at river basin level. Otherwise, if you're doing it just one part of a river basin for floods, if you create these decisions, if you take decisions at one part of the river upstream, it could have an effect downstream of raising the risk of people who are not even consulted of the decisions you're taking upstream. So these are complex systems that we're dealing with. They're trade-offs. They cannot be captured unless all the stakeholders whose interests could be affected are included. And I think that's a challenge for our governments around the world, but also OECD governments. I see it in the countries where we conduct peer reviews. We tend to still be governments run by technocrats. And technocrats think that they know better than people who are not technocrats. That's not to say, and many times they do know better, as a matter of fact. But that doesn't mean they're going to create buy-in for a policy by knowing better. Mm-hmm. And without the buy-in, you're not going to have the action. You're going to have informal settlements. You're going to have actions that completely undermine the policy that's been put in place. Now, I've been told I just have a few minutes. I don't have quite as long, but I'm going to be very active in our discussion going forward. And I just wanted to leave you with a few thoughts from our work at OECD going forward in the implementation of our own instrument at the OECD that's related to this topic, the governance of critical risks. We conducted a survey of what countries have been doing to implement it. And I think it's telling when we talk about DRR measures that we asked precisely, what are the priorities for strengthening disaster risk reduction in your country? And here I think there's some, well, you can judge for yourself whether this is good news or not. It's interesting, and that is just taking the top five priorities across the countries that were listed. The number five was increasing investments in protective infrastructure. So there are four ahead of that, all of which are non-structural measures. And I think that's pretty positive and a good way forward. Now there's context to that, which is that OECD countries have been investing in protective infrastructure for a long time. And so there's diminishing returns in many cases. Depending, this of course, is diminishing returns is project specific. And we have to look at different systems. We're not going to say across the board there's diminishing returns in protective infrastructure for an entire country. But to tell you some of the four priorities that came out ahead of investing in protective infrastructure, there was the likes of strengthening the enforcement of building codes, ensuring the provisions of building codes are informed by local risk assessments, strengthening the integration of hazard zoning and land use planning, and the top priority for strengthening DRR was increasing awareness of exposure to risks. So some of these soft measures, or sometimes called resilience measures, I think we do have sometimes terminology issues that even on our side, of course, we need to get in line with the newly adopted terminology, and we'll strive to do that. But I think that does give us a sense that there is an opening of the mind, even amongst the technocrats and engineers who permeate some of the ministries, that they can get more return on investment from some of these soft measures. Thank you very much.
Good, thank you. So we got pretty good time now for your questions. So I'll just highlight while you prepare yourself a couple of things that came up. Stephanie said something that actually I heard many times during the Sendai consultations and negotiations: governments can't do it alone. In the business sector, that normally is interpreted as governments are trying to push the cost of these things to the private sector. Yeah. So here we have a very important governance issue to tackle, because that is not, I hope not, the intention, but the intention is that also business engage in their own sustainability and long term. So the governance model is, I'm say to people, we have a huge opportunity here, but don't wait for the government to call you call them. because government work for themselves. That's their job. They've always done that. So how will they suddenly change their culture and start having all-inclusive models? MSB described to me yesterday the new model that they have been told to implement and what it means, and changing also how you actually work. Now, secondly, Jack, thank you. A very important discussion that you formulated for us on these trade-offs. Massive red tape, I like that also. You know, but this issue of trade-off, who is responsible for the trade-offs, actually? Once you have agreed to the trade-off, who's responsible for it? Because it may not work out the way you thought it should. So let's see if we have some thoughts around this going forward. You have lots of experience on that. And then just the final reflection here was this number one priority, awareness. In fact, this is, and it keeps coming up when we discuss with the business sector, if you only had one thing we should focus on, awareness. Mm-hmm. We all agree. How do we do it in a manner that it actually has an impact? So that's three of my immediate question. Now, put up your hand. These are not questions to you. I will put them to the panel, then you have your own questions. Please, since I don't know you, please introduce yourself.
My name is Åsa.
Wait for the microphone, please.
Oh. It's coming this way.
Oh, my name is Åsa Murray. I want to give you an example of a conflict in Sweden, which I think is very illustrative, so to say. We have a huge lake called Vättern, which is fairly... It's very deep and it's fairly clean. It's the drinking water of a large, of several surrounding local societies. And it is also a place where the defense want to make their shootings, and so it's the surrounding societies, they want to stop that, but the defense has, according to a law, a privilege always to don't care about the pollution they make, but they have when the government deals with it, they deal with, the defense is one thing, the pollution is another thing. But what you said is very important. They must also value both of it. And if they just continue to the old laws, there will be no change. And now we have a drought, almost, not quite a drought, but we have much less water in the east, south, east of the middle and south of Sweden. So that is a unique water to use for many people. So if you want to look at the risks, isn't drinking water something very basic?
Thank you. Let's take two more questions. Janet, I will put you on the list. We take some... two persons here first, and then we go to John.
Hi, I'm Mary Jane Johnson from Stockholm School of Economics.
I was just wondering about the measurement for risk, because like people would have different perceptions of risk depending on, there's cultural aspects to it. Did you consider the behavioral dimension of how they rate the risk, or how they, how you got the data for the risks?
Thank you. I'm Mark Reinhardt from the Institute here in Stockholm University. A terrific set of presentations. Quite a large spectrum of issues and problems to tackle. It is indeed very daunting. If you had to put your finger on one part of the governance system, local, national, regional, and international, what's the linchpin? If we were to force you to say, here's where the resources and the attention should go, what would you say it would be?
Mm-hmm. Yes, this question goes to Stephanie from Public Safety Canada.
Hi.
Thank you for your presentation. I actually have two questions, one about the national level and one about the local level. The first one is, first, congratulations on all the advancements you've made in putting together a lot of stakeholders for disaster risk reduction. So the first question about the national level is, how do you keep this multi-stakeholder platform together on the same track? Because, you know, in Sweden we have a big government, we're very used to cooperating with a lot of agencies and so on. It's easier for us to keep on track because everybody knows the issues and so on. But you're talking about making this very broad with non-government organizations and so on. So how do you keep from getting involved in issues maybe that are peripheral to what the government thinks is important, or something that might be too early to ask you this question, but I'm going to give a chance. The second question is about the local level, and what type of instruments or incentives do you have to help the local level to get involved? Of course, they have their own budgets and so on, but is there anything particular that you'd like to point out how you assist the local level?
We're at five. You're good. Yeah, you're efficient. Taking notes.
My name is Magnus Kvant. I'm from Brazilian Regions Association. I have a question for Stephanie Duran, and it's concerning the cost of these disasters. Mm-hmm. I think you were addressing the issue that we have to be able to calculate also the costs that are indirect, that are the consequence of the disasters. And we have done some work on that in Sweden, but I realize there is a lot more that need to be done. So I would like to ask whether you have any projects or any work on that in Canada, because I think we would be very interested in collaborating that.
So that's six.
Yes.
I think that's all you can talk through for the moment, but very important. Many of them touch exactly the issues of trade-offs, priorities, and how to do things. So Stephanie, why don't you start with some of the...
Okay. I think I'm going to go backwards, because I probably will, and I'll leave my colleagues also to answer some of the questions. So I'll just start with your latest question, the total cost of disasters. So that's the importance of the data and the evidence, so that there is a greater understanding of the impediment and the urgency of focusing on disasters. I will say that it is an area of research that we're looking into. It's the psychosocial aspect. There's also links to post-traumatic stress. At our national roundtable for DRR, just the issue with respect to gender and violence post-disasters in homes, where there is a trend that those that have faced disasters become vulnerable. And what I would offer is that it's not a cookie cutter. It does, we do, there are cultural
aspects, and it is about understanding, it goes to, you know, how people cope with stress and also the impacts of those disasters. Because when someone, for example, following Calgary floods or wildfires, it's not only the victims of the direct impacts of, to their homes and the population, it's also the impacts to first responders, to those that deal with disasters. So it is a new area, and I think would open to discuss it. It is actually an area where I think many countries are looking at to what are the health care costs of disasters as well, because of the impacts to mental health and PTSD, trauma, and just understanding resilience. Someone that has dealt with other issues in their life are not as resilient. So that also has an impact on decision making and how they respond to imminent threats. So that's what I would offer. So it's a new area. The second, your question. So thanks for that question. So I'm just going to go to my note. So the multi-stakeholder, yes. So it is, as you can appreciate, quite a daunting task, and it requires sustained engagement and a deliberate approach. We can't be everything to everyone, but it's also not to fill that space all the time. So it is about looking for those influencers with respect to those different sectors and creating governance that it is not about controlling from a federal perspective, but it is about, when I talked about enabling and facilitating and creating that space. Because governments don't always know best. And some of the initiatives are at the community level. So it's very important for us, as we do typical policy development work, that we engage so that it does resonate and at the end of the day will be implemented. Because the worst thing is to have, you know, this brilliant policy, but in practice doesn't work. So better take the time, invest in those consultations, creating that space for the different stakeholders to engage. But it is about how do you rally that energy. And, you know, it is about thinking outside the box, and it is about also that social innovation aspect, where we create some frameworks, we raise awareness as far as what are the outcomes that we're trying to achieve, and then we create mechanism to engage. And it's a different role for federal governments, but it's also to do it with all your different levers. So from a federal family with all the different departments and agencies, with provinces and territories, to create that space, which we do have that governance. For municipalities, for the local level, we work with the Federation of Canadian Municipalities, so they are the link. So it's about building networks of networks. And you try to look and map what are your key opportunities, and to be strategic. And not to think about the short game, but to think about the long game. Okay. So I think I'll ask my colleagues maybe to start on the other questions, and then I'll jump in too.
I'll come back to you before we close on one final question. Then we have trade-offs, we have water, we have our Lake Vättern. There's a question also about risk perception, I think, essentially. How do you measure risk? I'm sure you would like to talk about that, Jack, and then Andrew.
I'm not sure if this one's on. Yes, it is. I have to admit that behavioral economics is a new field that hasn't been so well applied, to my knowledge, of these questions. It's at the beginning. That said, the issue of don't build that nuclear reactor in my backyard is an old one, right? Or don't build those high-tension wires in my backyard. Or don't build that windmill in my backyard. It's good for someone else, but not for me. And a common good like defense, they have to do their training and their exercises as well. But it is a big country, Sweden, right? If I understand correctly, it's the second largest in terms of land in, after France in Europe. So there's a lot of space here where the exercises could be performed, I guess. I don't know the details there. But there has to be, I think this is a question in some ways for Andrew too. When you, how do you quantify these risks? Right? What's at stake? What's the benefit of defense exercises? What are the risks of contamination to the purity of the water? And that comes to the point of, let's have an objective, science-based, science-informed discussion of policy. And of course, it's not to deny that both sides have some interest here that needs to be furthered, but maybe there are alternatives. If I may, since I have the floor, I wanted to discuss the question that you asked before we went to the audience, Margareta, which is, how do we know whether policy decisions have been effective? Maybe I'm paraphrasing. Whether this multi-stakeholder process has really led to a decision and programs that are improving the situation. And I didn't touch on this point when I spoke, so I'll do so now. I think to complete a policy cycle, there has to be at some point the opportunity to take a step back and reflect and see, are we really attaining the objective that we want? What do the results show? Are our own measures for understanding whether we've been successful the right ones? Maybe we need to have some objectivity, an outside voice coming in to look at this. People who work in this field in other countries, experts like ourselves who can come and discuss with the stakeholders, not just ourselves and the technical services, but the interests, people who live with these risks, their associations, the businesses that are exposed. Is there a way for some outside objectivity to come into this point of reflection after some time? And that's what we've tried to do with OECD peer reviews. We've done these in Mexico, Italy, Japan, France. Right now we're conducting a second phase of a peer review in Morocco. We conducted these risk management peer reviews of Morocco in 2015-2016. In Morocco, the government was so impressed with it, they decided to come back and ask us, okay, now how do we actually go about implementing your recommendations? Can you help us set this up institutionally? So that's where we are. And we're in current discussions with Indonesia. We also worked closely with the EU, DG ECHO of the EU, of the Commission, and UNISDR to do these peer reviews in Finland and the United Kingdom. And these have turned out to be generally very, I think, a successful exercise of bringing some objectivity to these discussions. I think the key there is making sure that the right set of and the right mix of stakeholders are involved. So it's good to bring the outside objectivity to the discussion, but we don't want to just be speaking, of course, to the same people who have made the decisions in the host country. And there was another question about the linchpin. Now, where is the linchpin? And if I may hazard a guess, it's a very complex topic where policy interventions can happen at many levels of government. And I don't mean to say that one is unimportant. But the argument could be forcefully made that the impacts of disasters are always local first. And so we have to look at local capabilities to live with the effects and to manage the effects of disasters, but then also how do we reduce those risks? And one of the points that strikes me, looking around many countries, is that there isn't the legal authority at local level to tax. And many times there's no capacity either to be taxed if there was legal authority. So that's the first thing, as an economic reality. But secondly, if there were, there's no legal authority to tax, so that these often expensive disaster risk reduction measures could be financed by the people who are most concerned. And where I come from originally, the city of San Francisco, it's very heavily exposed to seismic risk. And people pay for seismic disaster risk reduction measures. We're taxed. There are bonds that we pay toward that go toward seismic retrofitting. So there is a share of that burden that's carried by the local community.
I'll talk a little bit or reflect a little bit on this issue of the trade-offs. And I'll use, one or two practical examples or case studies just to do that. One case, I mean, I particularly remember from, I think it was in the 2011 GAR we looked at, was the case of the Cayman Islands territory in the Caribbean. The Cayman Islands, I mean, as is most of the Caribbean, is affected by hurricanes. So you can be affected by Category 1, Category 2, Category 3, Category 4, or Category 5 hurricanes. 5 is the strongest, and 1 is the weakest. And they know pretty much, they've calculated what their risk is. They have the metrics. But when we were talking to them about their building codes and building standards, the building code in the Cayman Islands obliges anyone who's building, whether it's residential, commercial, or industrial, to protect up to a Category 3 storm. It doesn't oblige to protect up to a Category 4 or 5 storm. So that then begs the question, why does a country that actually has the risk awareness, has the risk metrics, knows it can be affected by a Category 4 or a Category 5 storm, has decided to put in place building codes that only protect it up to a Category 3 storm? So when we had this debate with them, I mean, the answer was very, very straightforward. Well, if I put in place standards to protect myself up to a Category 3, my cost of building sort of increases 10 or 15%. So investors can handle that. If I put in place something to protect myself up to a Category 5 and beyond storm, then basically the cost of building goes up exponentially. And I'll deter investment in my country. Mm-hmm. So that's a perfect example of a trade-off. You know, the country that needs to attract investment and needs to protect itself and took a very practical decision in terms of its building codes. This is my trade-off. I'm willing to protect myself up to here. I'll try and insure the rest of the risk beyond that. But I also need to make sure I continue attracting investment into my country. So for me, the key message here is that, I mean, two things. One is we actually do need the metrics. We do need the numbers so that countries or local governments can actually have that sort of discussion. If you don't actually have the numbers, it's impossible to have that sort of discussion and arrive at that sort of trade-off. But the second lesson, which is probably the most important one, is that the process is political, mm-hmm. and it has to be political. And unless we can get this subject, in a sense, outside of a sort of, let's say, esoteric realm of risk science and into real politics, whether that's at the local level or the national level, we're still sort of on the margin of what's actually really going on. So we need the numbers. The numbers, I mean, are objective in one sense. But the other important thing, risk always has a subject, yeah? You can have an object, but risk always has a subject, so it's always risk to who. So the other thing we always need to remember is that risk to the government isn't necessarily the same as risk to the inhabitants. Mm-hmm. Or risk to the private sector isn't necessarily the same as risk to the government. So we need the metrics. We need to know who the metrics are important for, and then we really need to have this political debate around the negative side of risk, but also the opportunity side of risk that can allow the trade-offs to be clearly identified and political decisions to be taken. So I think that's how I would address that. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Thank you.
And maybe just to build on that, because it's a really excellent segue to Canada's experience, I think political will is a conditions for success. I think it cannot stay in conferences or, you know, academia or really just having an S&T type of conversation. It is about, it does have to go to policy decision making, and that is a conversation of trade-offs. It is, what are the implications and the risks from an electorate? What are the risks from an economic? So, you know, municipalities get tax base from building. People like to live near water. It's beautiful, but it's dangerous. And if there's awareness of risk, they shouldn't be building next to water, because otherwise, you know, someone's going to have to pay for a potential disaster. So to the linchpin question, awareness for us, I think, at all different levels, understanding the risks and having that broad awareness at all different levels of government and across society, so that there is more informed decision making. But decision making at all levels, from a homeowner, from, you know, the municipal councillor, from a provincial territory programming perspective, and lastly at the national level. So I would say awareness, an understanding of risks to inform decisions. So it needs to be risk-based decision making, because there's so many priorities and there's so many trade-offs. But risk at the bottom line, it's not sustainable. We cannot continue managing risk the way we've been managing over the years, because that new reality, you know, it's skyrocketing. You're seeing the data. Science is telling us. So I do think that awareness, to your point, to your question, is what I would argue is the really important piece, and the political will is, to me, the conditions for success.
Good. Thank you very much, all the three of you. Now, when for the next panel, you will be in the audience, so you can then ask questions to some politicians, one from a regional level, sort of politician, but at least responsibility at regional level, and our state secretary. If I can draw any conclusions of what are priorities, it's more what you've heard the conversation centered on. Clearly the issue of governance is a real top issue, and I think what you hear there is some flexibility on how you model it, but I think, Stephanie, the way you described, I think it's actually very good, because you didn't put it the way I'm putting it, but I think this is what I heard. You shape the governance model around the networks and the people. You don't start with the model and then you try to That's stick right. everyone into it, because That's then you get misalignment and you get creaks. So I think that's a good way of thinking about how to be comfortable with the required flexibility but not exclude anything. Clearly metrics is something that will remain forever very high on the agenda. It's not so much about what you can't measure, you don't put value to it, but metrics here is the basis for understanding risk. And being able to do the trade-offs that you require. And then we have this constant issue of the awareness, which is, of course, not us telling others this is the way it is. It's genuinely an educational, co-educational, practical effort. And everyone is responsible for it. And I think that's probably the insurance industry always says awareness, and I've always said to them, well, can't we do that together then? Yeah. So I think the will is there, but we are not quite moving on with the issues, but I believe that's where we are quite now. And then in the end, I think you all come back to the political decision making. And maybe that's the real linchpin. So let's see how the next session develops. I thank Andrew, Stephanie, and Jack very much for coming. And you have earned a 15 minutes coffee break now. So see you soon.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.